All right, Shalom. First and foremost, I would like to give all praise and glory unto Yahweh, Bahashem, Yahushah, Bahashem, Rakakadash, double honors unto the apostles and the elders of GMS who rule well, teach well, being great examples to a younger brother, and peace and blessings, salutation, the hopeful lake out there pushing his word and truth and in sincerity across the four winds in the name of Yahweh, Bahashem, Yahushah, pushing to get up out of here. Shalom to the hopeful lake, the believers, the listeners, whom have came back to the obedience of the scriptures through faith in Yahweh, Bahashem, Yahushah. And what I want to get into today, all right, is responding to a question on the comment board, you know, dealing with Deuteronomy 24 and 16 and dealing with the account of King David, you know, and this is a clear example, you know, of the mercies that were shown, you know, unto King David, you know, for committing those sins he committed, all right, which ultimately we received the mercies, the sure mercies of David, you know, in this time, all right. Now, what I want to get is the brother, Spiritual Food 144, and he asked a question, you know, dealing with Deuteronomy 24 and 16, you know, which we'll get that, and then we'll get that account, you know, dealing with David. Now, you get the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 24, all right, verse 16, it says, the father shall not be put to death for the children, neither shall the children be put to death for the fathers. Every man shall be put to death for his own sin. All right? Because, now, let's say you had a father, you know, that was teaching, you know, false doctrine. Because being a false, teaching false doctrine was punishable by death. All right? You will put that person to death. It was found out that you was teaching idolatry amongst Israel. You will be put to death. So let's say you had a father that did that. Well, your father will be put to death. That sin wouldn't be upon you. All right. Or you had the situation where you had what they call a manslayer. You know, someone who intentionally murdered another Israelite. Well, you had a thing called the revenger of blood. And the revenger of blood, you know, he can only revenge the blood, all right, of the one who killed his brother, you know, or killed his family member. He can only kill that person that committed the act. He couldn't go after their mother, their father. He couldn't go after, you know, their brother, you know, their son. He had to kill the man that did it. You see, that sin was upon him. Now, dealing with this situation with King David, all right, which he had that child by Bathsheba, which it was an adulterous child. And that child, you know, the Most High plagued it, you know, the child. And he spared David, you see. So I can understand where the brother is coming from. But we have to understand the sure mercies of David and also what that represents. All right, the death of their child. All right, because after their child came Solomon, which was the mercy. You see. Now, when you go to that account in the book of 2 Samuel, now we're going to get, you know, go into the understanding of the sure mercies of David, you know. Like I say, that question, you know, sparked when you just do some reading in the spirit, you know. All right, now let's get the account and then we're going to read down and jump around, you know, hit the points. Now this is 2 Samuel 11 and 1. It says, and it came to pass after the year was expired at the time when kings go forth to battle that David sent Joab and his servants with him and all Israel, and they destroyed the children of Ammon and besieged Rabbah. But David tarried at Jerusalem. And it came to pass in the evening too that David arose from his bed and walked upon the roof of the king's house. And from the roof he saw a woman washing herself, and the woman was very beautiful to look upon. And David sent and inquired after the woman, and one said, "Is not this Bathsheba, the daughter of Eliam, the wife of Uriah the Hittite?" And David sent messengers and took her, and she came in unto him, and he lay with her, for she was purified from her uncleanness, and she returned unto her house. And the woman conceived, all right, and sent and told David, "I am with child." So this child was conceived in the act of adultery. All right, it was conceived in the act of adultery. So when you go to, all right, the book of Sirach, chapter 17, Sirach chapter 23, verse 18, it says, "A man that breaketh wedlock," was just what David did, "saying thus in his heart, who seeth me? I am compassed about with darkness, the walls cover me, and nobody seeth me. What need I fear? The Most High will not remember my sins. Such a man only feareth the eyes of men, and knoweth not the eyes, all right, of the Lord are 10,000 times brighter than the sun, beholding the ways of men and considering the most secret parts." All right, because when we go on to the story, we're going to see how David tried to conceal, all right, what he did with the Bathsheba, and she was with child, by doing what? Let's read it, and then we're going to come back to that. All right. And it says, "And David sent to Joab, saying, send me Uriah the Hittite. And Joab sent Uriah to David. And when Uriah was come unto David, David demanded of him how Joab did, and how the people did, and how the war prospered. And David said to Uriah, go down to thy house and wash thy feet. And Uriah departed out of the king's house, and there followed him a mess of meat from the king." So David is trying to pretty much flatter Uriah. He's trying to ask him about the war, how things going. And then he's, you know, trying to cater to him with the best meats and all these different things, you know. And it says, "But Uriah slept at the door of the king's house with all his servants of his lord, and went not down into his house. And when they had told David, saying, Uriah went not down unto his house, David said unto Uriah, come," it says, "camest thou not from thy journey? Why then didst thou not go down unto thy house?" And Uriah said unto David, "The ark in Israel and Judah abide in tents, and my lord Joab and my servants of my lord are encamped in open fields. Shall I then go into my house to eat and drink and to lie with my wife, as thou livest, and all thy," it says, and is thy soul liveth, I will not do this thing." So it didn't work, you know, because Uriah didn't want to go home because he didn't want to be in comfort while, you know, Israel was at war, his men was at war. All right, so that plan didn't work for David to try to conceal that marriage, that child, you know, because if Uriah would have went and lay with Bathsheba, then it would have been thought that that child that she had was Uriah's child, her husband, you know, but it was David's, you see. So he tried to cover it up, and it didn't work. And it says, all right, so eventually what David did was told Joab, which was his general, to put Uriah, all right, in the hottest part of the battle, you know, so that Uriah would have a good chance of being killed, you know, by those Ammonites. All right, so King David pretty much conspired a murder, you see. So when you go back into it, in Sirach 23 and 20, it says, "He knew all these things ever they were created. So after they were perfected, he looked upon them all." I read 19 to get the point and read 20 again. It's Sirach 23 and 19. It says, "Such a man only fears the eyes of men, and knoweth not that the eyes of the Lord are 10,000 times brighter than the sun, beholding all the ways of men and considering the most secret parts. He knew all things ere ever they were created. So also after they were perfected, he looked upon them all. This man shall be punished in the streets of the city, and where he is suspected not, he shall be taken. Thus shall it also go with the wife that leaveth her husband and bringeth in an heir by another. For first she have disobeyed the law of the Most High, and secondly she have trespassed against her own husband, and thirdly she have played the whore in adultery and bought forth children by another man. And those are three sins, just like King David had three sins. You see, when he numbered Israel, he committed adultery and he conspired a murder. All right, three sins punishable by death. You see, just as Peter, he committed those sins punishable by death. All right, and it says, Peter didn't commit three sins punishable by death, but he denied Yahweh shot three times. You see that completion, going to that number completion with number three. But you see how, you know, it's pretty much the same scenario that we're seeing with David. And ultimately, this is speaking of the elect. All right. The sins we've committed, the things we did punishable by death, we will be forgiven for. Hence the sure mercies of David. And it says, for she have disobeyed the law of the Most High, and secondly, she have trespassed her own husband, and thirdly, she have played the whore in adultery and brought children by another man. She shall be brought out into the congregation, and inquisition shall be made of her children. Her children shall not take root. And this is talking about adulterous children. All right, children born of adultery affairs, man. And it says that her branches shall not bring no fruit. All right, so children born in adultery would have curses, you know, on them. All right, they will have curses on them. We go to Sirach 4 and Wisdom of Solomon chapter 4. All right, verse. All right, this Wisdom of Solomon 4 and 6. It says, for children begotten of unlawful beds are witnesses of wickedness against their parents and their tribe. So that child of King David, you know, in Beersheba, all right, that was born through adultery was a witness against their wickedness, man. You know, and we're going to go into how the Most High was angry at David, you know, and that was part of his anger to take that child out, man. You see, and it says, reading Wisdom Solomon 4:6 again, for children begotten of unlawful bed are witnesses of wickedness against their parents and their tribe, man. So that, let's say the child was a witness, all right, of King David and Bathsheba going off, man. All right, and because if, you know, if my father committed a murder, you know, then the avenger of blood will murder my father. Well, I say the sin wouldn't be on me because my father and my mother, they was married. So I'm not, I wouldn't be an adulterous child. So that curse wouldn't be on me, you see. But the curse of that was on the child of King David and Bathsheba, all right, that was a cursed child. It was a child born of unlawful bed, you see. Now this is 2 Samuel 11 and Verse 22. So this is after Uriah was killed in battle, and the message came back to David. This is Second Samuel 11 and 22. He says, so the messengers went and came and showed David all that Joab had sent him for. And the messenger said unto David, surely the men prevailed against us and came unto us and us into the field and were upon them even unto the entering of the gate, and the shooters shot from off the wall upon thy servants, and some of the king's servants be dead, and thy servant Uriah the Hittite is dead also. Then David said to the messenger, thus shalt thou say unto Joab, let not this thing displease thee, for the sword devour one as well as another. Make thy battle more strong against the city and overthrow it, and encourage thou him. And when the wife of Uriah heard that Uriah, her husband, was dead, she mourned for her husband. And when the mourning was past, David sent and fetched her to his house, and she became his wife and bare him a son. But the thing that David had done displeased the Lord, Yahweh Bashimah Shah. So the Lord is within his anger right now at David. You know? And he's going to express that through Nathan the prophet. Now, Nathan pretty much tells David about himself through a parable. All right? And he's telling him, you know, how the Lord feels about what he has done. You see? It says, this is 2 Samuel 2 and 12. It says, wherefore hast thou despised the commandment of the Lord to do evil in his sight? Thou hast killed Uriah the Hittite with the sword, and has taken his wife to be thy wife, and has slain him with the sword of the children of Ammon. Now therefore, the sword shall never depart from thine house, because thou hast despised me, and hast taken the wife of Uriah the Hittite to be thy wife. It says, thus said the Lord, behold, I will raise up evil against thee out of thy own house, and I will take thy wives before thine eyes, and give them unto thy neighbor, and he shall lie with thy wives in the sight of this son. And you had that with Absalom, where Absalom tried to pretty much do a coup on his father, overtake the throne and the concubines that David had left, you know, to keep the palace. You know, Absalom dealt with those women on the roof, you know, in front of everyone. You see? So David had to bear the shame. He didn't go unscathed, you know, but he was spared. You see? He was spared. And it says, as you read on, and it says, and David said unto Nathan, I have sinned against the Lord. And Nathan said unto David, the Lord also hath put away thy sin, thou shalt not die. And see, now we're going to the sure mercies of David. You see, David has a unique situation, all right, outside of everyone else in Israel, you know, because it was a representation of the mercies that the Lord will have on the elect, the house of David in these times. All right. And it says, howbeit, because thy this deed, thou has given great occasion to the enemies of the Lord to blaspheme. The child also that is born unto thee shall surely die. So Nathan prophesied that that child was going to die. So it had to happen, you know, because he prophesied in the name of Yahweh Bashimah Shah. All right. And it says, and Nathan departed unto his house, and the Lord struck the child that Uriah's wife bare unto David, and it was very sick. David therefore besought the Most High for the child, and David fasted and went in and lay all night upon the earth. And the elders of his house arose and went to him to raise up, all right, to raise him up from the earth. But he would not, neither did he eat bread with them. And it came to pass on the seventh day that the child died, and the servants of David feared to tell him that the child was dead, for they said, behold, while the child was yet alive, we spake unto him, and he would not hearken unto our voices. How will he then vex himself if we tell him that the child is dead? But when David saw that his servants whispered, they perceived that the child was dead. Therefore David said unto his servants, is the child dead? And they said, he is dead. Then David arose from the earth and washed and anointed himself and changed his apparel and came into the house of the Lord and worshiped. Then he came to his own house, and when he required, they set bread before him, and he did eat. And they spiritually set that bread, you know, before him, you know, because you go into Yahweh Shah, what did he compare himself to? The bread of life. All right. And after David mourned, who was born? All right, let's get into it. And it says, then said his servants unto him, what thing is this that thou hast done? Thou didst fast and weep for the child while it was alive, but when the child was dead, thou didst rise and eat bread. And he said, while the child was yet alive, I fasted and wept. For I said, who can tell whether the Most High will be gracious to me that the child may live? But now he is dead, wherefore should I go fast? Can I bring him back again? I shall go to him, but he shall not return to me. And David comforted Bathsheba his wife, all right, and went unto her and lay with her. All right, now Uriah is dead. So by law, all right, this is a lawful engagement because Uriah is dead now. You know, when David goes in Bathsheba this time, all right, her husband is dead. So now this is a lawful is a lawful coming together. All right, now it was in some strange, it was an unorthodox circumstance, and you know you have somebody over righteous, you know, trying to besiege it. No, but no, these are the sure mercies of David. All right, in which we are all in need of the sure mercies of David. All right, and it says, and Bathsheba comforted. And David comforted Bathsheba, his wife, and went unto her and lay with her. And she bare a son and called his name Solomon, and the Lord loved him. You see that? And that was the mercy of David, was through Solomon, because he showed his anger through that child of adultery. All right, he was angry at David. But through Solomon, you know, that was the Lord's favor towards David, because Solomon would sit on the throne of David, and would have peace amongst Israel, be very prosperous. You know, that was the Lord's favor, all right, being shown. That was his forgiveness, you know, because David had what? That contrite heart. Because David didn't go sacrifice when he committed that sin. He didn't go sacrifice. He had a contrite heart, all right, because when you read Psalms 51, and you read the title, it says, to the chief musician, a psalm of David. When Nathan the prophet came unto him after he had gone into Bathsheba. So David was writing this after Nathan the prophet, you know, came and told him, all right, how the Lord felt and what was going to happen to him, what was going to be the consequences of it. But he said, thy sins are covered. All right. Thou shalt not die. You see? So David, now this is the spirit that David is in. Now when you jump down to 51, verse 11, Psalms 51:11, it says, cast me not away from thy presence and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. And it says, then that's what David was requesting. He didn't want that spirit to be taken from him. You know, he didn't ask about, you know, keeping the riches or keeping, you know, even remaining king. He just asked the Lord to keep that Holy Spirit on him. You see, it says, restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, and uphold me with thy free spirit. Then will I teach transgressors thy ways, and sinners shall be converted unto me. Deliver me from blood guiltiness, O power, thou power of my salvation, and my tongue shall sing aloud of thy righteousness. O Lord, open thou my lips, and my mouth shall show forth thy praise. So David begging for forgiveness, man. You know, and he said, you forgive me, my tongue gonna sing forth your righteousness. You see, just as we've been forgiven, and now we're singing forth the righteousness of Yahweh Bashem Al Shai. You know, it said, for thou desirest not sacrifice, else would I give it. Thou delightest not in burnt offerings. See, David didn't go offer up sacrifices, man. He fasted, and he had a very sorrowful mind towards about the wrong he done. You know, it says, for thou desirest not sacrifice, else would I give it. Thou delightest not in burnt offerings. The sacrifices of the Most High are a broken spirit, a broken and a contrite heart. O power, thou would not despise. You see, the sacrifices of the Most High are a broken spirit, which David showed that through fasting, not eating, you know, 7 days. You see, he had a real contrite heart for what he did. And that's what the Most High is looking for, man. True repentance, man. Inwardly. All right. Because a sacrifice is outwardly showing, you know, the sacrifice was an outward showing, you know, of forgiveness. But you can be planning your next wicked deed while you're sacrificing. Nothing is changing inwardly. But see, David, you know, he had a contrite spirit, you know, which he was torn for what he did, man. You know? And that's what the Most High accepted, man. That's what he's accepting now from the believers, you know? So what was David's showing of mercy was who? Yahweh Shai. I mean, was Solomon. And our showing in this time is Yahweh Shai. You see? Which, hey, it's the same spirit. All right, if you can receive it. Now, let's just prove it. Because Solomon's birth was a direct representation of the Lord's favor towards David, man. You see, just as Yahweh Shai, all right, his birth was a direct representation of the Most High favor towards his people. You see, because the Most High was fed up with us, man. Let's get this in Isaiah. This is Isaiah 1 and 11. It says, "To what purpose is the multitude of your sacrifices unto me? Said the Lord, I am full of burnt offerings of rams and of the fat of fed beasts, and I delight not in the blood of bullocks or of lambs or of he-goats. When ye come to appear before me, who hath required this at your hand to tread my courts? Bring me no more vain oblations. Incense is an abomination unto me. The new moons and the Sabbaths, the calling of assemblies, I cannot away with. It is iniquity, even the solemn meeting. Your new moons and your appointed feasts, my soul hateth. They are a trouble unto me. I said, I am weary to bear them. And when you spread your hands, I will hide my eyes from you." All right, and it's talking about prayer. Yeah, when you make many prayers, I will not hear. Your hands are full of blood. You see, your hands are full of blood. So was a time where the Most High wasn't accepting none of those vain sacrifices from our people, because they was doing hypocritically, man. They wasn't sincere. All right, he wasn't reverencing any of our high holy days with our people, just doing just to go through the motions. All right, when they would still have wickedness in their mind, conspiring all type of wickedness, man. You know, and the Most High was fed up. You know, and the only thing, all right, and Yahweh Shai was their representation of the favor. You know, the Most High opened up grace back into the believers, man. All right. So when you go to Isaiah 7 and 14, it says, "Therefore, now, when you go to Isaiah 7 and 13, I started 13, it's in the spirit too. And it says, "And he said, hear ye now, O house of David." You see that? He's addressing the house of David. It said, "Is it a small thing for you to weary men? But will you weary my power also?" It says, "Therefore, the Lord himself shall give you a sign." See, Yahweh Shai's birth was a sign, like Solomon's birth was a sign. You see, "Therefore, the Lord shall give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel." All right, and that virgin just goes into a young lady of marriageable age. All right, when you go into it, all right, it says Alama. All right, is a virgin young woman. It says of marriageable age, made or newly married. All right, which Joseph had sex with Mary. You know, she was newly married after she had sex. All right, with Joseph, man. You see, but I want to get that word Emmanuel. All right, which is in the Hebrew, which is it's an Ama no, it says Ama no Wa'ala. Ama no Wa'ala. And it says the Most High is with us, or with us is the Most High. Alright, and it was just a title, alright, for Yahweh Shai, which he represented the Most High is with us again. You see? And let's prove it. Alright. Because what was the purpose of Yahweh Shai? Alright, he was their favor. This is Matthew 1 and 21. It says, "She shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Yahweh Shai. For he shall save his people from their sins." You see? Just like David was told, what? Thy sins are covered. Where through Yahweh Shai, the believers, all right, the elect of this time frame, sins will be covered. Just as they was during, just as David's sins were covered, man. All right? So let's get another one. Because remember, Emmanuel means what? The Most High is with us. God is with us. Well, what does it say here? This is Luke 1 And 68, it said, "Blessed be the Lord, power of Israel, for he have visited and redeemed his people." Now, did the Most High come down here himself? No, Yahweh Shai. All right, it was just as if the Father was with us, man. All right, Emmanuel. It says he have came and visited his people. The Most High is with us. All right, through Yahweh Shai, you know. And it says, "And had raised up a horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David, as he spake by the mouth of his holy prophets, which have been since the world began, that we should be saved from our enemies and from the hand of all that hate us." You see? So he came to save the elect from their sins, and also to deliver us, to physically deliver us, all right, from our enemies in the earth, man. You see that? So Yahweh Shai was what? A representation of the favor of Yahweh Bashimah Shai. You know? And it says, "To perform the mercy promised to our fathers and to remember his holy covenant, the oath which he sware unto our father Abraham." You see? So Yahweh Shai's birth was a confirmation that the Lord was still going to execute that promise of our forefathers, man. But it was going to be through belief in him. And also the sacrifice that Yahweh Shai made that covered our sins, so we wouldn't have to face the consequences, you know, of these sins that's, you know, punishable by death. All right. Because working on the Sabbath is punishable by death. But there's some things we can't help. Now, we don't commit adultery. All right. We don't push idolatry amongst our people. You see, but there are certain things that we do that are worthy of death that we don't even have no control over. You see? So Yahweh Shai is the token of those sure mercies of David. Just as David sinned and should have been put to death, he was spared. Just as we're being spared in these times, man. And you get all the things we did before we even came into the truth. You know? And that grace is, it all starts with a child being born. When you go to Isaiah 9:6, what does it say? "For unto us a child is born." You see that? How it begins with a child being born. "And unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty Power, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace there shall be no end, upon the throne of David." All right, this is Solomon sitting on that throne. "And upon his kingdom, to order it and to establish it with judgment and with justice from henceforth, even forever and ever. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this," man. You see? So that situation dealing with David was a representation of what the sure mercies of David promised. You know? So when you go to Isaiah 55, all right, and 1, it says, "Ho, everyone that thirsteth, come ye to the waters. He that have no money, come ye buy and eat." Yeah, come buy wine and milk without money and without price. All right, and it's speaking of this truth, all right, it's likening it to truth, to the essential foods, man, of the earth. You see? And it says, "Wherefore do you spend money for that which is not bread, and you labor for that which satisfieth not? Hearken diligently unto me, and eat ye that which is good, and let your soul be delighted," all right, "in fatness," man. You know, because everything that we partook in, that we digested, right, that wasn't satisfying, man. Christianity left us with tons of questions not being answered. All these other religions and thoughts and, you know, the doctrines that's out there, it left us with tons of questions. It wasn't filling. But filling us, now we have Yahweh Shai, we're being fulfilled. We're being sustained in the spirit. You know? Verse 3 says, "Incline your ear and come unto me. Hear, and your soul shall live, and I will make an everlasting covenant with you, even the sure mercies of David." All right? Even the sure mercies of David. That's what it's all about. You know, the elect receiving those sure mercies of David. Verse 4, "Behold, I have given him for a witness to the people, a leader and a commander to the people." All right? So David was that witness of the sure mercies of Yahweh Bashimah Shai. You know, he received them. And the elect going to receive them, you know, in this time. you know, and it's through Yahawashi. So I just wanted to bring that out. Lord will, you know, that brother's question was answered, you know, and he was edified, you know. All you brothers and sisters were edified. Till next time, I say Shalom, Kwam Yashala, Baba, Baba, DTA, Sooner.